together. And Lord, just let this service speak to our hearts, draw us closer to you. May we have a good fellowship this evening. And thank you as we've celebrated Father's Day. May all the fathers continue to be blessed of you as you're our Heavenly Father. And we ask all things in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, you can stand up if you want. Sing. Turn to page 384. 384.
Thank you.
yonder. Anybody got a testimony you want to share tonight? Something good the Lord's did for you? God's just been good to all of us.
Amen.
Again, happy Father's Day to our dads here tonight. Appreciate all.
I was just thinking when we were singing that, have you been to Jesus? The last verse says, lay aside the garments that are stained with sin. You know, I had a t-shirt that I loved, and I wore all the time, anytime I could wear it, and it ended up with holes in the arms and stained up, and I still put that t-shirt on. I love that t-shirt, and you know, Julie would get me new shirts and stuff, and I still put that old one on. And I think sometimes, as Christians, we feel more comfortable doing the things that we used to do instead of doing the things that are new and fresh and God's will, because we like to sometimes slip into that old stuff that is stained with sin. And that just struck me as we were singing that I'm like that. I actually have a pair of jeans that I bought in 1975 at home. So I kind of hang on to some of that old stuff. But we need to lay aside those things that are stained with sin.
Amen. Amen. Give the Lord a hand tonight. We all need you. Right. Anybody else tonight? Yeah, Betty.
I want to thank God because yesterday I got choked on something and it just did not want to touch the hot dog. I was eating a hot dog and it just did not want to come up. And I don't know why, I just didn't pray first, but I was just trying everything, sipping hot coffee and just everything I could try. And I just finally said, Lord, please help me make this go down. And I turned that bottle of water up. Whereas it was just coming right straight back out. That water just went right down so smooth. Mm-hmm. And I was like, why didn't I just pray to start with?
You told me you spiked that about an hour, didn't you?
Yeah, oh, I was spiking about an hour. And I was like, pray, you know, God would have took care of us to start with. I believe in miracles.
He did anyway. You're here today, aren't you?
He's a good God.
Anybody else tonight? Something good? Something good the Lord's did for you? Again, as I said, happy Father's Day. Also, if anybody would be interested, next Saturday, June the 22nd, at 10 a.m. in Jeffersonville, Indiana, 1741 East 8th Street, where T.C. and Sherita Baker pastor church, Holy Trinity Christian Church, they will be having a free community health fair. If anybody needs some free health care to get looked at and stuff, maybe you don't have insurance or yours is not, you're not being able to get things checked for a while. But anyway, that's going to be next Saturday at 10 a.m. I know that conflicts with Steve's. If you're going to that, don't worry about it. But if not, again, that's down in Jeffersonville at 10 a.m. And then tomorrow will be our men's meeting at 7 p.m. Come out and be with us. We're going to try to watch part of a movie that we had Courageous, as I was talking about this morning. And we'll probably have to do that in two gatherings. And then Tuesday night will be the women's meeting at 6 p.m. So, again, we've got other things. We'll get into the Word some with our men's meeting, too. And I know they always do with the women's. But anyway, let's go ahead and we'll have prayer. I know we've got a special with Wayne here tonight, and then we'll get into that. Martha Roebuck, again, she had that heart ablation. She did say she did well with that, but just pray she don't have to go back into AFib again. Todd Padgett, he's having some kind of test run tomorrow, and also his mother, sometime Monday or Tuesday, is going to be having a heart ablation herself. So, just like Martha, so we want to pray for her. Still for Patty Goforth, for Sean Rush. And Shirley was telling me he's still doing pretty good, so we're going to keep him in prayer. Richard Tungate, I heard he's been having some hard ways to go. He had had knee surgery, but he's got other health issues too. Still for Charlie Jones, and also for my mother, Faye Wiggum. She just, it wore her out to get in here this morning, so keep her in prayer and pray that she can get her strength back and even get back in her regularly. But when she needs to be, not before that. I don't want to see her hurt herself. Still praying for Chuck Cranin that had back surgery and needs some other surgery for, he's got some cancerous situation, but he's got to get over the back first, and he's not doing real well with that. So continue to pray for him. Steve over here still having trouble with his throat and stuff. We want to remember him, for him and his wife both. Still for David and Melanie Wire. You said she had been in the hospital this past week?
Yes.
Okay. So... And then also Laverne Botkins has got a knee surgery coming up in July. And then Judy Hall, her heart monitor come out well, but she's got some other health issues, some kidney issues. We're going to keep her in prayer. Dean Lindemeyer not here tonight, but she had her last procedure where they were doing a skin graft on her knee or wherever it was at. Keep her in prayer. I think she's saying it's doing pretty good. And still, again, for Steve and Bonita Shaw, again, they haven't been here today, and I know they love to be when they can, but she just has the time. Gary and Tracy Higdon, and still for David and Dallas Intimate. And I also want to remember Elsie Day and her husband Ralph. I need to keep mentioning them. I know she's having a time with that. And again, for all those ones dealing with cancer, those ones dealing with hearts, praying for Karen Grace and her and Chris, also my wife Sandra, for Wayne's wife Janet, and again, as I said, all those dealing with heart conditions and other things. And then Lorraine Montgomery, we've got a call, Pat gave it to us the other day, or sent us the number, and we called them back, and she, again, that's the Corden lady, what was her name?
Jean
Corden, and then also Jan Graff. That was, they're all sisters, but Lorraine is not doing real well. And I think the last time I seen her was probably 3 or 4 years ago at a funeral service. I think at Grayson's the last time I seen her, but she's in the last stages of her health. So we certainly want to keep her in prayer. Still praying for Ronnie Huff. He's needing a stress test and he's having problems with, I think the insurance is messing with them on that also, and it's still for all of our families. So, and then there's a list of other people too. So, and you said there's an Alan Huff is related?
Alan Butoff.
Oh, Alan Butoff. Okay. wrote that down wrong, but is that a cancer situation too? Or?
Yeah, he had a grapefruit-sized tumor on his neck and jaw. He had that removed and went through all the chemo and the radiation and just found out that he's got to take some more. But now, Alan was a big guy. He's lost probably over 200 pounds. So,
Again, for all of our families, remember all of our loved ones, we all need, we got people in our families, and most of all, people in our families that need to be saved. And again, all the other things are secondarily when we think about it, because one of these days we're going to walk the streets of glory, and one of these days we'd like to have our loved ones with us, wouldn't we? So, prayer request up here.
Myself, friends and family, two unspoken after Leon Mendez.
Yes. Okay.
And Bill Riley.
Yes, Bill Riley and Rhonda Adams too, as we've mentioned. So, okay. Prayer request out here, anybody, either side?
Michelle? Family, friends, and for Lorraine.
Okay, absolutely. Lisa?
Yeah, for that little Addie.
Addie,
but it's a praise, though. Praise God, she's getting better, because the whole right side was paralyzed, and now she's moving her leg and her hand. So, praise God for that. Let's hope she just keep on praying for her.
Amen. And Judy Hall, still praying for her. Good heart monitor, but still got other issues. But I haven't said that. So, how many with uplifted hands for yourself, someone else? As we stand tonight, anybody want to be anointed? And if you don't want to stand, that's fine too. Excuse me, if anybody like to be anointed, you're welcome to come down. If not, we'll agree in prayer here tonight. Father God, we just come to you this evening, thanking you, Lord, for, again, this day, this Father's Day. Again, thank you for being our Heavenly Father. Thank you for our earthly fathers that you've blessed us with, and grandfathers, great-grandfathers, whatever any of us have had. And we just God, give you the praise and the glory for all things. Tonight, Lord, we just ask you, Lord, that you'll bless and anoint these needs that we have. Father, turn things around that just don't look like they have great hope. But God, you can take, again, as Steve was talking about earlier, you can open the Red Sea, you can touch our problems as well. We do pray tonight, Lord, again, for those such as Martha that had a heart ablation, and for Amanda Padgett having one this coming week as well. For those that have had procedures such as Patty Goforth and Sean Rush, we continue to hold them, and Richard Tungate and Dottie Roberts and Cindy Smith. Still praying for my mother, Faye Wiggum, that you'll touch and lift her up, give her strength and energy, be with her in every way, shape, or form. Still for David and Melanie Wire, with his knee especially, and for her with her heart and headaches, just touch and move upon her. Still for Steve and Bonita Shaw, and for Laverne Bikins with her knee surgery coming up in July. For Eddie and Violet, I know Violet was talking about having some health issues going on with her today. Just continue to touch their family. For Russell Powell, and also for Robin Hall that was here with us today. All the ones that have had not only knees and shoulders, but also back problems. Pray for my wife, as she's got a meeting with the people that have did her shots in her back, there in her lower back and close to her hips. I pray, God, as we meet with the ones this week, that God, they'll help us with the insurance to get an okay for her to be able to have that help. And again, it lasts for a while, but not for eternity. So again, we know everything in this life, we need to depend on you for eternal value for sure. And again, bless and anoint this gathering tonight. Pray for our country. Pray for the leaders of this land to turn back to you, those that are not. And again, we just pray, God, for our elections, for wrong people out, right people in. And again, for our country and our alliance with Israel, the Jews, and Jerusalem to be blessed and not cursed. We do pray for the peace of Jerusalem. And we pray for those people over there, that you'd be with all of them in the Middle East, and so many things happening in different parts. Touch and move upon all. And again, for shut-ins, caretakers, and unspoken, we pray for all these. And bless this time here together in Jesus' name. And again, for all the hands that went up, and for all the ones that will watch and listen another time for their needs, we agree in prayer too in Jesus' name. And all God's children said.
Amen.
And amen. Thank you. You may be seated. A couple of you want to do the offering. Faithful Lisa. Lord, we ask you to bless the offering tonight for those that give as well as those that have not to give. I use it for your kingdom. I bless those that again have to give and those that have not. And again, may everything we as Christians do be done to your glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Be a light and a beacon of hope to others through the faith and the things that God we have seen and have done in our lives to you. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Has God ever did anything special in your life?
Mm-hmm.
Saved you, didn't he?
Yep.
I mean, that was a wonderful thing, wasn't it? Has he ever touched you physically? Has he ever touched you maybe mentally or emotionally? Have you been touched by the Lord?
Yes.
I mean, I believe there's times that we may not even know it sometimes, but I believe the Lord's touched us many times, and we may not recognize it. As the sister said earlier, I believe in miracles. I believe God can still do mighty, working, wonderful miracles in all of our lives. And I know we can all talk about what's happened bad and what's terrible and stuff. And you know the good thing about it is even all the problems and the trials and tribulations you and I went through, we're still here. And he's still holding on to us. Again, he's still got his hand stretched out to us. He's still got that promise that I'll never leave you nor forsake you. And as we read here tonight, first of all, talking about Peter and then when they preached their first sermon after they've been filled with the Holy Ghost. And what verse did I tell you to go to? About
36.
Again, he's been preaching a sermon, but he says, "Therefore let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God had made that same Jesus whom you have crucified both Lord and Christ." Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart. And there's a lot more to this sermon than just that. But it says, "Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, Man and brethren, what shall we do?" Wouldn't it be wonderful if we could get people to ask that tonight, tomorrow, every time we gather together as Christians? What shall I do? There's other places where it said, "What must I do to be saved?" And again, this is kind of what this is basically implying here. What shall I do? Because we have crucified the Lord, and what shall we do? Because if we're going to believe Him, what needs to be done? Verse 38, "Then Peter said unto them, Repent, and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost." What is the remission of sins? If you've ever had cancer and you've heard remission, it's the glorious thing you can hear, isn't it? It means it's going away. It means it's leaving you. Sometimes remission is not as quick as others, isn't it? Again, I believe when you get saved, God sanctifies you, but again, and that means sets you apart, and again, He's cleansed you, but you got to keep getting, I don't know about you, but I take a bath more than once a week. How about you? I got to keep washing myself off. Maybe some that may not, but I think most of this crew here does. But at the same time, to stay clean, because I get dirt on me sometimes. How about you? I don't purposely get it on me. There's just this world's got a lot of dirt in it. You just can't help from things you see on billboards, for things you hear on the news, things you hear on anything, on that idiot box, anything. And then the internet, we've got that. A lot of us like to interact in Facebook. I don't know how to interact with other people, but I still go through it. Some of the things are very encouraging. Some of the other things are not so encouraging. Some of them are just flat not worth looking at, but you're flicking through there. But nonetheless, at the same time, remission means to take something away that's not giving you a good result. So remission of sins. "And ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost." And we have the Holy Ghost with us as children of God, but I believe we can even be more filled with God's Holy Spirit. "And you receive what you ask for." If you want something from the Lord, ask Him. If you want the Holy Ghost, ask Him. If you want healing, ask Him. If you want, you know, there's a song about that. If you need redemption, whatever it is, whatever you need, ask the Lord and He'll give it to you. But nonetheless, ask in faith, believing. But here, this is again, this is the first time that they preached the Word of God since the Holy Spirit has been poured out upon the church. And it says, "For the promise is unto you and to your children and to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call." Many are called, but few are chosen, aren't they? There's a lot of people. You know, God's not willing that any should perish, right? You know, some people have got the ideology. I've heard some of the teachings that you're already lost or saved when you come into this world. It's already figured out and you can't change that. Well, that seems like a waste for Jesus to die on a cross if that was true, doesn't it?
Yeah.
And again, I won't mention the doctrine that teaches that, but some of you've heard of them. And it's like, man, why even deal with salvation if I'm already lost or saved? And again, they may have some other things that twirl around it. I don't know. But nonetheless, I know that, again, you have to be saved to go to heaven. I know that you have to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. But anyway, I'm getting ahead of this. And it says, and with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from this untoward generation. Then they that gladly received his word were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them about, look at that, 3,000 souls. And I've mentioned that before, and there's other places that talk about some different numbers. But isn't that wonderful that in that first message, 3,000 people, and it says about, I believe, again, unto them about 3,000 souls. Wouldn't that be wonderful to see 3,000 people in Charlestown get saved tonight? Whether it was in this building, or was it was in the church building, or whether it was up there on the square, even with you all singing and things, whatever it was, wouldn't it be wonderful? It's wonderful to see 3 souls get saved. It's wonderful to see 1 soul get saved, praise God. But to have 3,000 of them, can we believe God can still do that today? If you don't, there's no sense in even thinking about it, is there? You got to believe to receive, don't you? You got to pray and seek the Lord. And again, I know, as I said, every one of us, again, we have some times that we need to just keep God. You know, one thing I pray for all of us is God, give us clean hands and a pure heart and a renewed mind. That's one of the things I'm praying for myself every day. And I'm praying for all the congregations too at the same time. We all need that. Clean hand denotes our relationship with other people. Pure heart denotes our relationship with God. But renewing of the mind is something you don't do one time. It's something you continuously do. Be not conformed to this world, as Romans says in 12:1-2, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind in Christ Jesus. And again, that's something you continuously do. You don't just get saved, and, you know, you'll never have to keep renewing it, and your mind will always be perfect. One thing, you got to stay in God's Word, don't you? Another thing, you got to stay in fellowship. I know people say, well, I don't need to go to church. No, but I guarantee you, if you want to be closer to the Lord, you're going to get around people that are close to the Lord, aren't you? I mean, when I was drinking, I liked going to the bar. That's where the drunks was at. I don't know about you, but that's where you hung out, right? And again, if people are doing drugs and stuff, they want to go to where the drug houses or people that sell it, that's where they go to. And that's why we come to church. We don't come to church to be a bunch of stiff-necked hypocrites, but we come to church because we're people that need to grow in the grace and knowledge all the time too. I'm not there, you're not there, none of us reached that. It don't matter if you're Billy Graham, and I know he went on to be with the Lord, but he had some growing to do until he went on to be with glory, and now he's growing forever, praise God. And all of us, I hope, want to be that same way. Not passed away right at this moment, but when we leave this old world, just getting closer to God all the time, praise God. Nothing wrong with that. But anyway, it says, and they continued, verse 42, and they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and in the breaking of bread and prayers. And they went from house to house many times, and they were doing that. And again, those were the things that built each other up. The apostles' doctrines, their teaching, their fellowship, gathering together, the breaking of bread, communion. You know, we do communion the last Wednesday of the month here. We're going to start doing communion, hopefully, the fifth Sunday morning of the months that have five weeks in it. What we're going to try to start doing on our Sunday mornings. That's coming up week after next. I know some of you go to other churches, but we're going to try to start doing that and just pray that that'll have an adverse effect on us as a church to see great things happen. But anyway, and it says, bless you, in verse 43, and fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles. And again, we know that they were done by the apostles through the power of the Holy Ghost. It wasn't the apostles' own strength and power, but through their obedience and through what God's gift and calling was. And all that believed were together and had all things common, and sold their possessions and goods and parted them to all men as every man had need. Again, that was a community. And by the time we get to Acts 5, we realize that that didn't work too good. You have a hard time with that. But nonetheless, and they continued daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house. did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God and having favor with all people, and the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. Now we are vessels of God that are supposed to be watering and sowing. We sow seed, we water seed. Some people say, well, you know, it's the pastor's job or it's the evangelist's job. Can I tell you, it's all of our job, because what you share with your children, what you share with your neighbors, what you share, you're sowing seed. Last week when we were having VBS, that was all of our prayers that were working with that. God, let there be seed sown into these children. And again, not trying to get on a tangent with VBS, but I've heard a lot of people tell me that there's things that happened in their younger age when they were at VBS that stuck with them the rest of their life, and then later on they get saved, and some of them, not all, but some of them get, you know, basically the reason for them being saved was the VBS that touched their hearts, and later on God used that. And I know we've had some kids that have given their hearts and lives in VBS, and again, it was just a move of God. It's been some years back, but at the same time, I know God can do that. But anyway, it says, praising God and having favor with all the people, and the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. Reading on into the third chapter here tonight, and it says, now Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour, which actually is 3 o'clock in the evening to us. And a certain man lame from his mother's womb was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms or gift giving. In other words, he was begging of them that entered in to the temple, who seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked an alms he wanted to give from them. And we all know this story. And Peter, fasting his eyes upon him with John, said, look upon us, or look on us. And he wasn't asking him to look on them like they were something special. He's saying, give attention to what we're going to say to you. And he gave heed or listened unto them, expecting to receive something of them. One money is what he was looking for. And he knew, as well as all of us know that are Christians, money don't fix everything, does it?
No.
I mean, you can have all the money in the world, and I know it's a tool, I know it's a help, I know you like to have it when you need it, and I know it's nice to have finances when you're trying to pay your bills, but you know as well as I do, when somebody's sick and you've done all you can do with money, you want God's intervention. When you got somebody that's lost and undone without God, you know you can't pay their way into heaven regardless of what some evangelist may say to you. And again, I'm not saying they ever said that, but they come pretty close to it sometimes. But at the same time, money's a tool and all that, but it's more to it, life, than just money. As a matter of fact, money is the root of all evil, but that's not really what it says, is it? What does it actually say? The love of money is the root of all evil. Nothing wrong with money, but when you have a love for it, where you put it as a god. But anyway, and he gave heed unto them, again reading verse 5, expecting to receive something. Then Peter said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. How long had that man been lame? It said from his mother's womb, didn't it? That's a long time. Now, he's a grown man. And he's been laid at that gate of Beautiful asking for alms for years and years and years. Can you imagine now all of a sudden somebody's getting ready to pray for him to receive his healing? Can you imagine again what the difference would make? And it says, rise up and walk. You know, sometimes when you give somebody expectation, you got to kind of help them along. You know what? It says, and he took him by the right hand and lifted him up. You know, maybe that's something we ought to think. And again, I'm not just talking about healing, but anything. You know, when we're praying for something, believing in somebody for something, we might need to take them by the hand and help them get along with that. You know, your faith helps build me up. My faith helps build you up. You know, Steve, I know, was talking, and some others talking about, you know, testimonies, I think, some things about a song and some others. But at the same time, when you hear a testimony of what God's done for somebody else, doesn't that do something for you? And again, I'm not talking about something drug out with all kinds of this, that, and the other, but I'm talking about when you're talking about what God did for you. God healed you of cancer. God got you through a heart procedure. God got you through losing a lung. God got you through some eye problem. God got you through some kind of walking or something. God's done things for every one of us here, I dare say, haven't He? And again, when you testify that to others, that builds others' faith up. And again, the best thing that it builds up is you too, because when you say that God healed me, you know where your healing comes from, don't you? When you say God saved me, you know where your salvation comes from, restored or whatever. And He took him by the right hand, lifted him up, and immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. And he, leaping up, stood and walked and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. That guy was happy, wasn't he? That guy was joyful. I mean, it wasn't just, you know, we get into church and we read these things and it's like, it's just a quick thing. And it's like, this man's went through this problem for years and years, how many ever decades old he was, but he's went through that. And now all of a sudden, you know, somebody that has faith in Jesus Christ has spoken to him, and because of his faith in Jesus Christ, and you say, well, I don't see that. You will. But because of his faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, through their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, that's why he was able to get up. He had evidently heard about the Lord Jesus Christ through them or others, because we'll read about that. And it says, and he leaping up stood and walked and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God. You know, that's a testimony for sure, isn't it? That's just like the ones that were in prison that one time we talked about here lately, you know, when they were shackled and everything else. And you remember the chains fell off and the doors opened. But they was in there at midnight praising God after they'd been beaten severely and was chained up to a wall. And again, a whole different story there. But again, getting back here, it says, and they knew that it was he, talking about this man that was healed from being lame, which sat for alms at the beautiful gate of the temple, and they were all filled with wonder and amazement at that which had happened unto him. And as the lame man was healed, held Peter and John, all the people ran together unto them in the porch that is called Solomon's, greatly wondering. Again, wouldn't it be wonderful if we seen that outpouring of the Spirit on our church today and all our churches in this area today, and started seeing healing where somebody got up and walked that had never walked before. People started seeing that had never seen before. Have we got the faith to believe that? And I'm not downing you because you haven't, and I'm not downing you because, you know, you have a struggle with it. I'm just saying, wouldn't it be great if we could get our faith to just believe that God can do anything? Because I believe He can, but, you know, when you're in a situation, it's sometimes hard to hook up to that, isn't it? Just to be honest with everybody. But it says, and as the lame man which was healed held Peter and John, all the people ran together unto them in the porch that is called Solomon's, greatly wondering. And when Peter saw it, he answered unto the people, "You man of Israel, why marvel you?" Over verse 12, "Why marvel you at this? Or why look ye so earnestly on us?" Remember earlier he had told that man to look on him, but that was just to gather his attention. But now these people are paying attention to him like they've done something or something. None of us have never saved a soul. We've never healed a body. We've never restored anything. But God has used us all as vessels one way, shape, form, or another. And whether you've had 45 or 100 or 1,000 people pray the sinner's prayer with you, have you been a light to your children? Have you been a light to your grandchildren? Have you been a light to people around you? God has used you. And again, if people get saved, it could be a lot of times because you sowed and somebody else watered. And again, that plant grew up somewhere along the line, and then fruit came off of it, which was salvation for people. But it says, "Ye men of Israel, why marvel ye at this? Or why look ye so earnestly on us, as though by our own power or holiness we had made this man to walk?" We got to make sure we don't ever get that thought that some man, you know, you've seen some of these big whizzes on TV and stuff like that. I'm not downing them, but I've chased them before. I've had people wanting me to help chase them. And I went to some of these things, and sometimes what you see is not the same thing you see is what, you don't get what you think you see anyway. And it's a little bit frustrating sometimes. But God can still heal, and God, and I'm not saying all of them are like that. I'm just saying some of them, again, is just a little bit more show than they are real. I'm not pointing at anybody. I'm just saying we need to get a hold of God and realize He's the one that gives the power. He's the one that gives salvation, healing, deliverance. And again, reading on here, it says, "The God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob, the God of our fathers, hath glorified His Son Jesus, whom He delivered up and denied Him in the presence of Pilate when He was determined to let Him go. But ye denied the Holy One and the just and desired a murderer to be granted unto you, and killed the Prince of Life." That Prince of Life is none other than Jesus Christ, whom God has raised from the dead, whereof we are witnesses. And His name, through faith in His name, has made this man strong. Not faith in us, not faith in our church, not faith in our congregation, but faith in Him. We're talking about Jesus Christ. And it says, "And His name, through faith in His name, hath made this man strong, whom you see and know, yea, the faith which is by Him." You have to have faith yourself, folks. Other people can build your faith up, but you've got to have it in yourself for what you believe in. "Hath given Him this perfect soundness in the presence of you all. And now, brethren, I wot that you, through ignorance, you did it, as did also your rulers. But those things which God before has showed by the mouths of all His prophets that Christ should suffer, He has so fulfilled. And here we go again. Repent ye, therefore, and be converted." What does it mean to repent? It means to turn from your ways to God's way. We talked about that in our Bible study this morning. Again, the word metanoia, it means to take on a new set of ways. In other words, to have your heart changed, to have your mind changed. And again, for your mind to be changed in God, it's going to have your heart changed first of all. Your spirit has to be different. And it says, "But these things which God before has showed by the mouth of all His prophets that Christ should suffer, He has so fulfilled. Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord, and He shall send Jesus Christ." I thought He done did. How many of you know He's coming back again? How many of you know one of these days He's going to come back for His church, isn't He? One of these days He's going to come back not only for the church, but then after that, I believe, He's going to come back and set His kingdom up on this earth. And one of these days, it's going to be completely Him, isn't it? I'm looking forward to that day when there's no Satan, when there's no powers and principalities of the air, when it's nothing but Jesus, nothing but God, nothing the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost. And again, that'll be the refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. "And He shall send Jesus Christ, which before was preached unto you, whom the heavens must receive until the time of restitution of all things, which God has spoken by the mouth of all His holy prophets since the world began." You know, God's always had a purpose for the end of time. The Bible says it was already foreordained in the mind of God that Jesus was going to die for us on the cross. Because God, Jesus, the Holy Spirit, the Father, they're all one, but at the same time, there's no timing, you know, the Alpha and the Omega, and again, it's hard to confront what that means. Again, God's always been, God is, and God always will be. But God the Father already knew, and I believe the Son and the Holy Ghost already knew, and again, I'm not trying to make that confusing with the Trinity, they're all one, but they already knew that Jesus was going to have to go to an old rugged cross to take away our sins. They already knew, I believe, even before the foundation of the world, even before Adam and Eve did what they did, they were given a simple commandment, and God already knew they were going to fail. You think God already knew we were going to have failures in our life? But He still loved us, and He still committed to us, and knew that He would bring us back from where we were at? For Moses truly said unto the fathers, a prophet shall the Lord your God raise up unto you of your brother, like unto me, him shall ye hear in all things whatsoever he shall say unto you. Notice the fathers. In other words, they passed down the message all the way back, again, about generation to generation, how there would come a Messiah, how there would come a Savior, how there would come somebody that would change their lives. And it says, and it shall come to pass that every soul which will not hear that prophet shall be destroyed from among his people, yea, and all the prophets from Samuel and those that follow after, as many as have spoken, have likewise foretold of these days. Ye are the children of the prophets and of the covenant which God made with our fathers, saying unto Abraham, and in thy seed shall all the kindreds of the earth be blessed. Unto you first God, having raised up his son Jesus, sent him to bless you, and turning away every one of you from his iniquities. I'm so glad I'm saved. How about you tonight? Amen. I'm glad he turned me from my wicked ways. You know, we read about 2 Chronicles 7:14 when we talk about our country. If my people, which are called by my name, will turn from their wicked ways and pray and seek my face, and again, all those things, and he said, I will heal your land and save your nation. You still believe that tonight? And again, I know that was for Israel, but I believe for us, it will do that. It will turn from our wicked ways. And again, if we'll pray and we'll seek his face and do all the things that God has called us to do, basically serve him, turn from our ways. You love the Lord tonight?
Amen.
Let's stand tonight. Let's close in prayer. Again, remember, guys, we have a men's meeting. If any of y'all would like to come and haven't been here before, you're welcome to do also. And then the women's Tuesday night. And remember, our church service is Wednesday. So, and singing on the square and something go on about every day sometimes, isn't there? So, but Father God, we thank you for our time here tonight. And we pray, Lord, that you keep us all safe as we go to our homes, wherever we go at this evening, and bring us back safely together when the time comes. Bless and anoint every life here tonight for every need that we have, that we can glorify and honor you. We ask it all in Jesus' name, and all God's children said,
Amen.
Amen. God bless you, and again, come back and be with us.